out of our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Reading that is appointed for today from Exodus chapter 20 and from verse 1 to 17. Then God spoke all those words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other God before me. You shall not make yourself an idol, whether in the form of any being that is in the heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, I am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquities of parents, to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For six days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son, or your daughter, or your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your town. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and the earth, and the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving to you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord. reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians, the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a market. destruction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
To remind people that Jesus was always in the room. that's just like the Jesus image we carry around in our heads every day. Every one of us is tempted to construct our own Jesus out of bits and pieces of Jesus' words and deeds that we particularly like best. The parts that go with our own preferences and temperaments. The parts that agree with what we already believe and value. The parts we feel comfortable with. The parts that look like us. But the Jesus who never challenges us, who never gets angry, is an idol, a false god. So, what was really going on with the story back then? So let me give you the backstory. In Jesus' time, worship in the Holy Temple in Jerusalem was going through a very bad patch. Here's how the system was supposed to work. The temple was run by the high priest. Other priests and their assistants, the Levites, performed the animal sacrifices that would connect people to God. If you wanted to offer a sacrifice, you were required to bring a suitable kind of kosher animal to the temple for your offering. An inspector would make sure that the animal was perfect, with no blemishes of any kind, suitable for offering to God. You would come in and hand it over to the priest, and he would sacrifice it to God on your behalf. You were also required to pay a fee to help support the work of the temple, which is only fair. Just as the animal you brought for sacrifice had to be the right kind and a perfect specimen, the money you paid for the fee also had to be the right kind. A coin without any graven images on it. A coin with a graven image, such as the coins from the Roman Empire and any place else in the world, or that had the head of Caesar on it, or another king, would be unclean. You had to take that money to a money changer, have it changed into Jewish coins, and then you could then make your temple offering from them. And the money changers were allowed to take a small commission on every coin they changed, which is only fair because that is how they made their living. The whole system was possible because there were money changers to change the money. Now, in years past, there were money changers and sellers of animals in the city to provide a necessary service for all Jewish worshipers, for helping them to have the right kind of money and the right kind of animal to sacrifice. Unfortunately, during Jesus' time, this whole system had broken down and become incredibly corrupt. Instead of being selected by the Jewish leaders, the high priest bought his office from the Romans. That cost the high priest a huge bribe. Now, the high priest had to get the money for the bribe from somewhere. I mean, huge bribe. Okay. But he wasn't allowed to help himself to the temple money. That was sacred and off limits, but always had it. So he figured out a way to skim money off the system to raise all this money to pay off the Romans, and not incidentally to enrich himself. The high priest set up his own money changers and animal sellers so he could have a monopoly if possible and make the money off their profits. But where could he put those money changers and animal sellers? He appropriated the outer court of the temple. And you're thinking, like, well, so what? That's just where people were coming in. It would be convenient. That's where the vault was located. The Jewish people had been welcomed and offered hospitality to foreigners who wanted to come and visit the temple and help in worshiping God. But the law did not allow those foreigners to come into the inner precincts of the temple. Only practicing Jews, including converts from all those other nations, not just, you know, Jewish people by descent, but Jewish people by conversion, were encouraged and welcomed. All the people practicing Jews and converts were allowed to come into the middle of the temple where everything was going on, but the foreigners were allowed to stand outside and watch. There was no wall around it, you know, at the beginning. You could just stand outside the gates and see everything going on. And there was a lot going on there. Not just the sacrifice of the animals, but liturgies throughout the day, the burning of wonderful incense, and the Levites had musicians and dancers who performed every day. It's glorious. And when Herod the Great, King Herod the Great, came to the throne, by then there were huge numbers of people who were coming to see what was going on in the temple. And he decided to expand greatly the outer court area to make it a really welcoming and beautiful and formal part of the temple. So there was this glorious, gorgeous, pavemented outer court where it was just a low wall and knee-high that separated you from what was going on in the new parts. So everybody could easily see the court went all the way around the whole temple. So you could look in and look at everything. It was really great. One of them was one of the wonders of the ancient world. It's called the Court of the Gentiles. And it had lots of room. And the temple guards were instructed not to even let anybody come in through there who was trying to make a shortcut to the city. That was absolutely prohibited. So only for the Gentiles, for them to be able to worship God. And it was the beautiful Jewish ethic of welcome and hospitality and encouragement for conversion. Until Jesus' time, when the high priest crowded that court with his money changers and animal sellers, clogging up a commercial enterprise to fund not just to bribe money for the Romans, but you know, inevitably, plenty of cash for him and his pals. Now, as you might expect, the high priest alongside money changers and animal sellers also had to charge higher prices to make up for the payoff to the high priest. So, okay, well, maybe it wasn't that bad, but what if you were a pilgrim and you were coming and you didn't want to pay the higher prices in the temple? You could go outside and buy an animal or change your money, right? No. The high priest created a monopoly of money changers in the temple. They were no more allowed in the city itself. And if you tried to buy your animal elsewhere, it was still allowed. Or if you wanted to bring your own with you, that was still allowed. But surprise, surprise, when you brought it into the temple, the inspector would always find something wrong with it. So you would have to be forced to buy a new one in the temple. What effect did this all have? Honest businessmen in the city were put out of business. Gentiles were forced to worship God in the middle of a crowded market full of animals developing, and crowds of Jewish worshippers bargaining over the coins and the animals. Pilgrims to Jerusalem would find that they had to spend huge amounts of money to fulfill their religious duties. And sometimes they didn't have the money to get home on. Many poor people couldn't afford sacrifices at all. And so they couldn't keep the Jewish law. But the high priest and his supporters got rich. And that's what angered Jesus. He needed to make a public statement about it. Of course, now, if he just stood there preaching against it, who would have heard him? Nobody would have listened. Everyone had a profit motive for being there, and it was pretty prophet thing. So when he started doing it, they were like, of course he's doing the prophet thing. That was to make a demonstration of a righteous protest against injustice. He symbolically disrupted business as usual. Not with violence against people. That whip was for the animals to get them out of their pens. It was not for people. And yes, he raised his voice in anger, so he could be heard. Now, of course, he was just one person. Notice, he did not involve his disciples in helping him. He did not want to get them into trouble. And he couldn't evict any of these money changers or animal sellers from the temple, from the court of the Gentiles. There was no property destruction. Coins got gathered together. Animals were herded back in place. Tables were set back up again. Nothing got broken. Business resumed shortly thereafter. Jesus even couldn't even shut down their business for more than like an hour tops, maybe. So why do we bother? Why bother doing something which would have so little immediate impact? Because he was making a statement. One that could drown out. One that would start people talking. And maybe one that will lead to change. And that's something that protesters still do today when they are making a righteous protest against injustice. Disrupt business as usual in a way that will make people pay attention. Not destroying property, not using violence against people. But enacting a vivid demonstration of what righteousness should look like. One that people can't drown out. One that will hopefully lead to change. This Jesus cannot do for us. This Jesus is the Jesus of warm hugs and comfort when we are hurting. But there is another Jesus. The Jesus who is filled with righteous anger against oppression. The Jesus who teaches us to care when other people are being mistreated. Stand up and make a vivid public statement about it. A statement that uses Jesus' methods of nonviolence, but one that is sufficiently loud and passionate that it will disrupt business as usual, get people talking, and hopefully lead to change. So, what injustice are you passionate about? What might you do to be part of making that vivid statement?
diocesan bishop and all members of the clergy. We lift our eyes to the hills, O God. We pray for our nation, for all the nations of the earth, and for all who govern and judge, especially Joseph, our president. We lift our eyes to the hills, O God. We pray for those who put themselves in harm's way and places of danger, those who willingly risk their lives, particularly for those serving as peacekeepers. We lift our eyes to the hills of God. We pray for those who hunger, who thirst, those who cry out for justice, those who live under the threat of terror, and those without a place to raise their head, especially the victims and refugees of the violence in Gaza and Ukraine. We lift our eyes to the hills, O God. We pray for those who are ill, those in pain, those under stress, and those who are lonely. We lift our eyes to the hills, O God. We pray in the season of Lent for those who prepare for baptism and renewal, and we pray that we all might be given the grace and strength to invent and grow closer to you, O God. We lift our eyes to the hills, O God. We pray for those who have died and those who have entered into the land of eternal life in your abiding place, peace. We lift our eyes to the hills of God. I ask your prayers for those people and situations in our hearts, which we now offer to God in the silence of our love.
Who now live by faith, may with joy behold thy Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Okay, where's the camera today? And move them out. Okay, so we got that. All right, let's share the peace first with all people who are watching with us on the interwebs. We have approximately 20 people who worship with us, so online. So let's offer them the greeting. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
join you to have a really, really refreshing Lent. If you have chosen some spiritual discipline for Lent, background Ash Wednesday, and maybe it isn't like sticking too well with you, or you're not enjoying it as much as you hope, I want to let you know that you can feel free to ditch it and try something else. We have in the back of your announcements handout long lists of all these different kinds of things that you can choose from. We also have some other things we offer as a moment for here, which are two prayer trips per week. And as well, we have evening prayer at the common room during Lent. Evening prayer is at 5:30 Monday, Wednesday, Friday, right here in the chapel. And common is Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, 8:30 p.m. online only. And of course, everything is online, which is the evening prayer is usually put online too. You can watch it or measure over the next couple of days afterwards. So consider all of those things. And the Episcopal Church members will be meeting this week. Tuesday, March 6th at noon in the community room for the round back lunch and hang out with some really fun people. And believe it or not, Easter is coming. So you all have those handouts as interior service leaflets about purchasing Easter lilies to decorate the church. Let us know if you would like them to be in memory of, and we will publish that name, or in honor of, for a living person. And secondly, we have this really great tradition here at Holy Trinity that on Easter morning, we don't offer a normal coffee hour. We have a full-bore brunch, a champagne brunch. So please let us know about that.
We will be having a lovely champagne brunch on Easter morning, so I will be getting with Christina at the office and Richard Julie and getting sign ups out. So people can help bring food items, bring lunch, things like that, just to make a lovely event for Easter. So look for that coming out in the next newsletter. So, second thing, really quickly, is that there's still a couple spots open for evening prayer. So, if that is something that you might be interested in doing, it is a very lovely, peaceful way to end the day. So, there are sign-ups on the for that.
That's sign-ups to read it, but it's always completely open. So, I think that is everything I have. And our offertory sounds is free. Oh, Sally has an announcement for you, Sally.
Thank you for your patience. I really am so pleased that we are going to have a full Eucharist at the Knolls of Oxford this Tuesday. It'll be the first Tuesday of every month. It will be consecrated or officiated, whatever is the Episcopal word, by the Reverend Kip Colbert. And it is not only for all Episcopalians at skilled living and assisted living, as we have been doing now every Tuesday with Peter Lindsay on occasion when we can, with Jim Michael, and so often with the Deacon Dave, who arranged for it to all happen. But it will be for independence living in the Knolls. But it is also going to be our trial of inviting other denominations who are not served with the worship service and communion at the Knolls. We would love for any of you, and I know for many of you who are going to be at the Episcopal Church Women Gathering, it might be a little bit more to add, but if you can join us at the Knolls, 3:00 this Tuesday, it's going to be in the auditorium, which is the big building that you find with the flagpole. Just come inside the door and we'll be able to lead you there. Thank you.
our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we will ever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of the name.
Christ, our Passover, his sacrifice.